Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
And those decisions may be favorable in your sight. Lord, we thank you for all you do for us, and these things I do pray in your name. Amen. Amen. All right, please stand for a Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have three public speakers signed up for tonight, and Ms. Hook will be our official timer. It's a three-minute time period that you may speak, and the first person to speak is Mr. Tom Scoggins. Mr. Scoggins.
Thank you. I'm here regarding the longevity pay. I was disappointed that 27 days after you folks were started the new board that you decided to give restore the 55% pay to the county employees. I'm a taxpayer in this county, paid close to $40,000 last year between the county, Burlington, and the city of Graham. You decided you're going to go ahead and restore this pay. In spite of the fact that it was decided to give the employees a 5% increase when 55% was taken away. So what's going to happen if you restore the 55% along with the 5% that you took away, then instead of given 115, I figure $115,358 that they received, you want to add another $500,000 approximately to it when you restore what's been taken away. Because they've been drawing this extra 5% pay. I'd like to see everybody have as much pay as possible, as much as we can afford. I just don't see that we can continue to afford it. The economy is not as good as you might think it is. I had a building that before 2008 was appraised at almost $1,200,000. The best offer I get for it is advertised for 4 years. Somebody said they'd pay an appraisal on it, and then they would give me 40% appraised value. I ended up selling a building recently for $300,000. Got another building for sale on the tax books at $358,000. I'm trying to sell it for $250,000. Haven't been able to move it in about 3 years. Things aren't as good as you think they are. As a matter of fact, if they're all that good, I wonder why we would give Southern Seasons almost $100,000. Take one away from my neighbors over in Hillsboro, so we have 45 jobs. Things are not that good, folks. And I appreciate Commissioner Smith's comments that I think you're the least weight and do a continuous thing in the 2014-15 budget. I appreciate Mr. Smith bringing that up. I would like to ask for a longevity pay for the county taxpayers. You'll give away any longevity pay. I've been here since 1965 and paid hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Next, we have Mr. Tony Cox.
People all over the world are going to the streets in protest. We can't breathe. Hands up, don't shoot. Political favors have destroyed the world. They're continuing to destroy the world. It's amazing what the politics of this country will do. I told somebody the other day, I said, the United States of America, local, state, and federal government, 21st century, has been, is, and continues to be on the fast track for everything that this country said that it stood against. But who cares, right? Let it go. We don't care. Political favors, political tortures. It's amazing. Our prisons are full of innocent people. I remember back, I think it was around 2010, a girl come in here. She had been cited for having an illegal junk mobile home. And there was a grant money that I think at that time it was said here at this podium that it was given $1,600 per mobile home to help people get rid of them. There was an article in the newspaper last week or week before last that said that the new planning director was helping people get junk mobile homes off their property. Penny Cox, no relation to me, stood up here and she said, boy, I sure would like to, but I just can't afford it. It seems like I recall Mr. Boswell saying, do we not have any money to help this woman? Nope. Policing for profit. That's what it was. We got a lot of problems. You know, I was on a good, steady track. I was going to the top, but because of political favors, and then come into this room right here, and then politics line, politicians line to do political favors, that world was turned upside down. During special subcommittee hearings on the Alamance County High Impact Land Use and Polluting Industries Ordinance, your law legal department said that there are many inherent problems with the law, but enforced them anyway. I wonder if the Wade place out there on Mark Drive, when a big political donor got a property for nothing out there, basically.
Thank you, Mr. Cox. Next speaker will be Mr. Lance Reitenberry.
Chairman Engel, a lot of people think I can't see out of my left eye, but I got double vision and I'm going to take it off so I can see two of y'all tonight. Because it is very heartwarming for me to stand up here tonight, see Chairman Engel, Vice Chairman Boswell, Commissioner Byrd, Linda Mass, and David Smith. I'm a people person. I've stood here several times for the county employees. I've seen them herded into the overflow room, not allowed to sit out here. That's wrong. A last minute deal took their longevity pay away. 5% pay increase didn't do anything. All that did was take the longevity pay's gone. We've got good county employees. We have dedicated county employees. If we don't return the longevity pay and start looking after our employees, say here, Mr. Smith probably remember, I think Eddie Boswell remembers, heard him call inmates, prison asylum. How does that reflect to other counties that we'd have a commissioner talk about our county employees? We've got county employees, ask Susan the hospital, we've got county employees that are on food stamps or that can qualify. If you train a county employee you've got a good employee. Yeah, like another commissioner said, for everyone that leaves, there's 100 waiting in line. That may be true, but how much is it going to cost you to train that employee? Is that employee going to be as good as the one you just had? I don't think so. I think it's a bright day for Alamance County. County employees showed their support and who they wanted for county commissioner. And I salute my county employees.
Thank you, Mr. Roddenberry. Commissioners, any commissioners have any comments in reference to our speakers tonight?
I'll wait till we get to the agenda.
I understand. Anyone else? All right, with that being said, I have a little something here. If you'll just bear with me just for a second. I'll walk down to the podium. I want to ask you if Commissioner Smith would join me here at the podium, please, sir.
Easy as you think.
I understand, sir. I want to read something to you, sir, if I may. This is a resolution honoring David I. Smith and celebrating 50 years as a North Carolina lawyer. Whereas David I. Smith has been honored by the North Carolina State Bar in celebration of his 50th anniversary of admission to the practice of law. And whereas the Alamance County Board of Commissioners wishes to recognize and celebrate the importance of David I. Smith's role in its long and rich 165-year history. And whereas it is important for the people of Alamance County as a whole to recognize the history and contribution of leaders in our county. And whereas David I. Smith has served as a state Superior Court judge, county attorney for Alamance County, Alamance County clerk, Alamance County Manager, Alamance County Commissioner, and Chairman of the Board of Alamance County, a career of exceptional public service unprecedented in our county. Now therefore be it, and it is hereby resolved, that the Alamance County Board of County Commissioners congratulates David I. Smith upon being honored by the North Carolina State Bar in celebration of his 50th anniversary to practice of law, and celebrates his service to the state of North Carolina as a Superior Court judge and his service to Alamance County as its county attorney, county manager, county clerk, county commissioner, and chairman of the Board of Commissioners. This 15th day of December, 2014, signed Dan Engel, Eddie Boswell, Linda Massey, and also
Robert E. Burns.
Judge, I thank you, sir, for your service. Alamance County is a better place because of David I. Smith, and sir, I thank you for your service and your continued service. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Isn't that good?
I think you just have to live long enough.
We appreciate you, Judge.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, sir. And as you have a seat, there's a couple people, too. I'm going to let them speak just for a few minutes. They want to say a little something about you. Yes, sir.
I'd like to say something, if I may.
Yeah, we recognize our attorney, Con Albright. Mr. Albright, you may speak.
About 30 years ago, a very young attorney appeared in that old courthouse over there in front of Judge David Smith. I don't know if you remember it or not, but I certainly never forget it. It was one of my first motions for subrogation in a workers' compensation case. You had black hair then. So did I. But I'll never forget it. I worked on that motion, and I rehearsed it, and I went in there and walked in the courtroom. Matter was called, stood up, gave my speech, and David Smith, Judge Smith, said, "Motion denied." Just like that. And I said, "Well, Judge, I'd like for you to reconsider." And you said, "Mr. Albright, is this not totally within my discretion?" And I said, "Yes, it is, Your Honor." And he said, "Motion denied." And so I packed my bags and left. And when I interviewed here for the job of assistant county attorney, I prayed that he wouldn't remember that. But I appreciate what you've done, and great honor being a 50-year attorney. That's something. Been a pleasure to serve with you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Albright.
Thank you, Clyde.
Our sheriff, Sheriff Johnson.
Yeah, I'm going to add a little humor to it. But, you know, I had an opportunity to come in as sheriff in 2002. David was our county attorney. And after a few years of, arguing with the county attorney on who's right and who's wrong, he became county manager. And we had an opportunity to build the new jail over here. And I got two stories I want to tell you that sort of makes David what he is. First one was after they built the new jail. Our jail was 2 years late in opening. The air conditioning unit was put in when the jail was built, and it was 2 years before it opened. So the warranty ran out on the air conditioning unit, but before it ran out, I come over to David Smith. I said, "David," I said, "we need to get an extension on this warranty on the air conditioning system at the jail." He said, "The thing ain't been running much." I said, "It's going to be all right. Don't worry about it." I said, "Well, then would you mind initialing right here that we refused?" Well, it wasn't but about 6 months after that, the unit broke down. And they wanted several $1,000s to fix it. So I go back over to Judge Smith. And I said, "Judge Smith, well, this air conditioning unit broke down." He said, "One thing should be under warranty." I said, "No, sir." I said, "We had the chance to extend that warranty." "Well, what idiot didn't extend it?"
Nobody said I was perfect.
The next thing I'm going to tell real quick, I know it's nighttime, but when he became county manager, parking was a tough around the city to get parking places. He said, "Sheriff, there was a place beside the air conditioning unit back there." Oh. He said, "Look at him." He said, "Sheriff, if you don't ever do nothing, Sheriff, you make sure if there's a car in this parking place and it ain't mine, you tow it. You hear me?" I said, "Yes, sir." Well, it wasn't probably 5 months that his car had a problem, so he takes it to the Chevrolet place to get it fixed and gets a bars of car. Well, I come out and I see that car sitting there. I said, "Oh boy." And I knew that he had borrowed that car. So I got two of my deputies to go around to the Chevrolet dealership and get an extra key. They come back and move the car around to the Lexi board. And this is David Smith. Every time I come up, he's like, "Sheriff, have you done anything good today?" So he'd always make great news. I walk in and be bopping in his office. He said, "Sheriff, have you done anything good today?" I said, "Judge," I always call him Judge Spirit. I said, "You're going to be so proud of me." He said, "What have you done? Who you put in jail?" I said, "I ain't putting nobody in jail, but I tell you what, there's a car parked in your parking place and it's towed by a man." So he walked around. He said it to death. He said, "What'd you say, Sheriff?" I said, "We towed the cars in your parking place." I won't use the nouns that he used. Anyway, he said, "Sheriff, that was my car. Mine was being fixed, and I had to, that's a user car while they're fixing mine. What have I got to do to get it back?" I says, $125. He rubbed his head again. He got up, got his cape. He said, "Will you take me to get my car?" I said, "Yeah." As we walk, we go out the back door, we go where his car is parked. They run, he stops, and he says, You ain't joking, are you? Anyway, we told him where to call it. I'm enjoying it. And you're to be honored for the years of service you've given to the criminal justice system and also to this county.
Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you, Sheriff and Judge. Many of us refer to you as Judge, whether it be staff or commissioners. That's because you are our judge, and we thank you, Judge. Thank you for all you've done.
Thank you, Judge. Appreciate you very much.
Yes, sir.
What Terry Johnson just said gives you some indication of how tough it was being county manager and having to put up with him.
And all God's people said.
Next on our agenda is the approval of the agenda. Do I have a motion to approve the agenda for tonight?
I'll make a motion.
Second, thank you. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Now the consent agenda. Commissioners, you've had a chance to look over. Is any items to be withheld from the consent agenda? Do I have a motion that we approve the consent agenda?
So move. All right. Approve of the consent agenda.
All right. Now second.
Second.
Second, Linda. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. All right. Going to item number 7, the audit presentation, Crystal Roberts. Thank you, Crystal. Welcome.
I think I just hit this button. Oh, here we go. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, for having me tonight. I'm Crystal Roberts. I'm from Martin Starnes & Associates, and as you know, we conduct your annual financial statement audit, so I'm here tonight to discuss your 2014 results. First of all, we issued an unmodified opinion on your financial statements. An unmodified opinion means that's the highest level of opinion a county can receive. It was a clean report, meaning there are no material misstatements in your financial statements. We also issued an unmodified opinion on your compliance, which is our opinion on your federal and state awards. There were no findings in your compliance, and we tested several of your larger programs, with Medicaid being your number one program. The report was submitted to the Local Government Commission today. There was a holdup statewide on the compliance side, which held your report up in comparison to other years, and that was due to the State Auditor's Department not being able to provide Medicaid numbers for us, and we have to go with their numbers. And I would like to thank Ms. Roberts and her entire finance department for all their hard work and cooperation, and they are more than prepared for us when we come in to do our final fieldwork procedures. The next slide here, The next slide here is your general fund summary. You can see your revenues are in the burgundy color and your expenditures are in the green color. Your revenues came in at $128 million and your expenses came in at $125 million. That was an increase for your revenues over prior year of $1.6 million, and your expenditures were up around $3.7 million. This slide does not include any long-term debt issued and does not include any transfers in and out. After your revenues, expenditures, any long-term debt, and any transfers, your total fund balance increased right at $5 billion. So your total fund balance for fiscal year 14 came in at $31.4 million. Out of that total fund balance, the Local Government Commission keys in on your available fund balance. To get to available fund balance, I'll show you the calculation on the next slide, but the Local Government Commission considers available fund balance important because it represents what you as the board can appropriate in your next fiscal year's budget, and it's also the number that the state uses to gauge your fund balance in comparison to others of your size and in your peer group. To get to available fund balance, you take your total fund balance, you minus out your stabilization by state statute, and that number represents primarily your accounts receivable on hand at year end. The state considers those accounts receivable unavailable to appropriate until they're actually collected, to come to your available fund balance of $24.3 million, and that was an increase over your prior year of $4.3 million. The Local Government Commission then takes that 24.3 and it divides it by your general fund expenditures to come up with a percentage, and your percentage increased around 3% and came in at 19.4% in 2014, And this is positive results for the county. As you, if you recall, in 2012, your fund balance available was right at 11%. You increased it to 16.4 in 13, and so 3 more points is definitely positive results in 14. I'll move on now to your enterprise fund. Your landfill is your enterprise fund. You can see your operating income came in at $539,000. Your investment and capital asset, that's a classification of net position or fund balance in that fund. It primarily represents any capital assets that you have on hand, net of any related debt that's associated with those capital assets. And what's left over is unrestricted net position or fund balance. And your total net position came in at 20.6, and that was an increase over prior year of around $6 million. And that was very high level, but I'm prepared for any questions that you may have.
All right, questions from commissioners.
What is your desired percent of fund balance as a percentage of general operating expenses?
Your peer group, the state posts these statistics every year, however there's a year lapse. So the 2013 results came out in March or April, so that's usually your 14 will come out in 15 of March and April. In 2013, your peer group had a 24.75% available, and so you can compare that to the 14% that I had showed you on the previous slide of 19.4. But that's still huge leaps between 12 and 14. Statewide average for all counties is around 25%.
Is that pretty wide distribution from?
It includes all populations, all peer groups, yeah. All 100 counties. The average is 25%.
And how big is our peer group?
You know, I'm embarrassed. I have to look on my phone because I didn't print it, but I did pull it up when I got here. I do have it here. Your peer group is in the, if I could see.
They did need accept.
100,000 population and above. Yeah, that was a big zoom. Anything else?
Further questions?
And Mr. Chairman, I do want to thank Martin Sarge for the work that they did, but also finance and also all of our departments, because again, this is an incredible turnaround and really a 2-year time frame in looking at our fund balance and where we were at 11% and now at 19%. It's really a lot of hard work and dedication of our employees, and we've been budgeting well. Revenues have, you know, we have seen a small turnaround in sales tax. We've had seen a small turnaround of motor vehicles. We've had seen a small turnaround in state shared revenues. So we really have positioned ourselves well by being lean, that we've been able to have this fund balance come to us. But it's really a work in progress, and we do appreciate the effort.
What is our percentage of undesignated fund balance that the LGC requires?
There's no statute as far as a requirement.
That,
the local government
require
commission
8%.
They do. They recommend at least 8%.
Well, what is ours now?
That is the number. The 8% correlates to the available, the 19.4.
And that's 8%?
Their recommended is at least 8%, and that number is growing.
I know that, but what is our percentage?
Your percentage is 19.4.
19, okay, 19. Well, good.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Any further questions? Thank you, ma'am. I'll entertain a motion this time. Approval of the audit.
I'll make a motion that we approve it.
I'll second. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time. Have a great night.
Is there a time frame when you think we'll get the hard copies?
I should have mentioned that, because almost all 100 counties started flowing in all at one time, and it was practically around a week ago. The local government commission has told us that it may take, in the past, they could turn reports around within a week, sometimes two, depending on the size, but we're looking at 3 weeks, especially with the holidays coming up. But just as soon as they'll give us our approval, we do your final prints, and we'll send them to you.
Okay. So end of January, maybe?
I wouldn't say the end. I would say at least by mid.
Mid-June, okay. All right, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Next on our agenda is ACTA emergency funding request. Mr. Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have been requested by ACTA. They have been audited by the State of North Carolina on their rural operating assistance program. In the past, they've been allowed to use some of that fund for urban trips. They kind of cracked down and said you can no longer use that funding for urban trips. And to now, to get them through to the end of the year, they need a one-time allocation from the municipalities and the county of about $101,000. And the recommendation that we're looking at is to fund half of that, which would be the $50,506. And the municipalities picking up the other half of it. And but this will be a one-time allocation that we would take from our contingency fund. And that's contingency funds are funds that are budgeted.
Questions?
Is Ralph here?
Ralph's right.
Oh, there. Good.
Didn't see you there. Ralph is here also. If you have questions as well, did I explain it fairly?
You did. Okay. Basically, we started the...
Please come up. Please come up to the podium, Mr. Gill. Thank you.
We basically started the year with the anticipation that our funding out of ROPE, Rural Operating Assistance Program, would be the equivalent of the prior year in 2013-14. So as we started year 14-15, in July 1, we went through to September on schedule, and then we received a notice from the state North Carolina Department of Transportation that we're being cut $98,000 in that fund. And then a week later they came back and said, well, we found some money, but the cut's going to be $50,000. And then a week later we received notice that we really needed, our board needed to look at discontinuing using ROPE for general purpose trips, that was to only be used for rural trips. And this all coincides with the move overall to start having transportation in the urban area funded out of 5307 grant funds, and rural trips would be done out of traditional ROPE funds. We're being transitioned to that fully in 2016, but we looked and said there's too much risk that the state would come back and ask for that money back if we spent it. So as of October 1, we discontinued using the ROPE money. We're taking the money that the municipalities gave us this year, which was $47,000, and we're using that to run between October through middle part of December, and we'll exhaust all those monies. And we have done a number of things. We reduced the number of trips that we were running by limiting individuals to two trips per month. These are typically used for people needing to go to the grocery store or for some medical appointments. We also have people that go to work on these type of trips, and we were taking them every day. We limited them to two days per week round trip, or five single days. We said we would get you to work if you figure out a way to get home. And so a lot of people have elected to do that. But we did a calculation with these reduced number of trips. We said it would take $101,000 to provide this limited trips through year end. Talking with Craig, we felt like we would ask the county for half of it and the municipalities for the other half. Of the municipalities, Graham and Mebane and Elon have approved their allocation request. The city of town of Hall River declined. I think it was $3,000 on their end. Mm-hmm. City of Burlington will meet tomorrow evening to make a decision on the $30,000 that we're asking for them. And once again, ACTA appreciates everything that the commissioners have done for us since our inception in 2002. and I look forward to coming back and giving you an update on the changing transportation environment and how it will impact ACTA going forward. But our request is for $50,506.
All right, thank you, Mr. Gillum. Any questions?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I serve on the ACTA board. I have served on it for about 3.5 years, and former Commissioner Paisley is on the board now with me, and we fully endorse what Mr. Gillum is asking for here. It's much needed.
Any further questions? Do I hear a motion?
I'll make a motion that we provide the $50,000.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item is Register of Deeds, personnel request.
Is Mr. Webster? Webster?
Is Mr. Webster
not here?
Not here. So we'll pass on that and go on to discussion of our finance organizational chart. Mr. Honeycutt.
I will turn that over to you.
You're going to defer to me?
I will defer to you.
Well, in simple layman's terms, it would be just a matter of moving the chief finance officer back under the county manager. That's what we'd be voting on. Any discussion on that?
Yeah, I could support that if the board before pass this motion would appoint our present interim director, permanent finance officer.
Well, that's, Judge, that's an admirable thing, and she is prepared to move. I think, Mr. Honeycutt, would you like to address
The conversations that I've had with Ms. Roberts is that decision is up to her if she so chooses and wants it. I think she's been filling out, I'm sorry if I'm speaking for you. I believe she is filling the position out. I think she is more than qualified to do the job. I think she has the trust of not only the finance staff, but also of the entire county government organization, I think the board as well. So again, that move or decision would be hers. If she did decide to take the position, we would make that permanent, and then we would look to hire a second position. With Susan and I have had some conversations. We would hire and do that through staff. But again, the ball's in Susan's court.
You spoke just fine.
Okay.
So she's not really certain she wants it yet full time. Is that, I mean, permanently? Is that what I'm hearing?
I have really enjoyed the opportunity that the board has given me over these past few weeks to fill out the position fully. I've talked to Craig. This has let me get my feet wet to see everything that the job would entail, and right now, commissioners, I am in favor of assuming that role.
And I have no problem with the judge's
decision. Right on into this before it's over, right?
I think she
would
said
you
yes.
Like to make a motion?
I'd like to move that the board appoint our interim finance director, permanent finance director.
Under the county manager.
No.
Oh.
We do that, and then we put her under.
Okay, so.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All right. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No.
No.
All right. You want to make the other motion, Judge? You're on a roll here.
I'll make the motion that we put the Office of Finance Director under the county manager.
I'll second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? No. Motion carries. Thank you.
And, Mr. Chairman, just to let you know, number one, congratulations to Susan. But number two, we will be looking at filling her position. And we're going to do some probably a little bit of reorganization with the position. But again, we will begin on that really as soon as possible. Start tomorrow.
Thank you very much. Moving on to item five under number seven, the reorganization and position creation. Sheriff Johnson, you have the floor.
Good evening, Commissioners. Over the past couple of years, we've had a tremendous high volume as far as work coming into the sheriff's office with the number of employees we have. And we have been using a lot of part-time employees to try to offset the workload. And just give you an example of what's going on. From January to December of 2013, we had to respond to 44,093 calls for service, and that was through central communications, not counting those investigations where people walked into the office. So far this year, as of June 1st, as far as we go back, we've already answered 38,333 calls for service, not counting what walked through the door. Problem we're having is with the whole department. We have a court system. They'll tell us, you know, hey, we're expecting 350 this morning, so we're bringing part-time help. Well, 350 don't show, so they continue to the evening, and the part-time help's gone, and we've had to draw people in from the road, from the administration, to come in to handle courtroom security. So what I'm asking is to take, we're doing away with seven part-time positions to make three full-time positions, so we'll have those people there around the clock. And what that will entail is moving $69,709.40 from our part-time position line item, which is $43,010,126, to full-time, three full-time positions, which would be $43,010,120 line item. For the second half of the year, begin January 1st, that would be moving $69,709.40 from part-time monies to full-time monies. And then in the budget year for 2014-2015, we will remove the remainder for a full year, which would be $139,418.80. And we're wanting these positions to be deputy two positions, which their base salary is $34,923, and with benefits, approximately $46,472.93 per man. This will help our agency to become more efficient and stop me from having to come before the commissioners and ask for more personnel. Y'all want us to tighten our belts, and that's what we're trying to do, and that's what this situation is allowing us to do.
Thank you, Sheriff.
So you're basically just swapping dollars for...
Swapping dollars, and the part-time monies will come over in the dollars to cover the three full-time right. positions. We will lose seven part-time positions, but we'll be able to be more efficient. So anytime during that day, if we had to pull somebody in or whatever to handle the large court overflow and stuff, we could do that. Also, we're looking at one of the positions to go to human trafficking, which is a dire need in this county right now.
So this is budget neutral, is how I would ask. Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir. It's budget neutral. Right. No more cost to the county, sir.
Just letting him run his department like he needs to.
Thank you, sir.
You're right. All right, and I've seen personally, especially in the afternoons, and that's when it really gets to be a problem, where a judge will call over to the sheriff's office and say, Sheriff, we're starting up a high-profile trial. We need three bailiffs in this courtroom at 2 o'clock, and the part-timers, they've gone, and you know, this will eliminate that problem. So I think it's money well spent and moved, I might say. Do I have a motion at this time?
So moved,
Mr. Bird, second by the judge. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Thank you very much.
Next item is item number six under number seven, the longevity pay discussion. Mr. Honeycutt.
Thank you, Chairman. At our last meeting, there was a discussion about looking at the implementation of longevity, or at least the 55% that was not fully funded in this year's budget. And one of the questions the board asked was to come up with some actual dollar figures so we know what we're doing. The other issue was we wanted to wait until the audit was presented to the board. So the audit has been presented. And if we look at the total cost for all departments, it is 500, there it is, $578,675.38. That does include the landfill, but that also includes all benefits, because as you're aware, the retirement, you know, benefits have to be paid on any salary that is given. So, but that total cost is $578,675.38.
Thank you, sir. Comments from commissioners?
I'll start. 18 months ago, in the 2013-14 budget, the county gave our employees a 5% across-the-board raise, first raise it had in 4 or 5 years at least. Cost for that was $1,768,789. Last year, the board took 55% of the longevity fund away, which was $597,000, take a few cents. 2 weeks ago, under the performance management program, county paid the employees $536,657. Now that amount of pay to the employees offsets the 55% longevity fund. So the figures come out that this year, the employees are getting a full 5% increase in their pay. But over the last 18 months, the county has paid the employees $2,305,000. That's more than 2 cents on our tax rate in 18 months. And all I'm saying is I have no problem. What the county also did was the 45% that was left in the fund balance, in this budget year, it was given to the employees in their regular salary rather than as a payment toward the end of the fiscal year or annual year. So we're looking at about $600,000 to implement this now, when in fact the employees are getting their full 5% this year. We don't know how much the performance management program will net them next year, if any. So what I'm saying is, what is the rush and why are we doing it now, $600,000 that's not budgeted, that comes out of our fund balance? And we've got to remember that this budget year we have $3.5 million of fund balance already budgeted in this budget. And you add $600,000 more, we're going to have $4.1 or $2 million of fund balance. And about 6 years ago, we had the same fund balance that we do today, about $31.5 million. Over the next 3 years, the fund balance dropped $12 million. Our bond rate was cut. We got a letter from the LGC saying, you know, you've got to shape up. It's a little embarrassing when you're sitting on the board here in the Department of Treasury, the Treasury Department in the state is chewing you out because you're not watching your finances. So I'm saying I have no problem with considering it at a later date. I just don't see why we need to put $600,000 more dollars in expenditures when we can budget it and know exactly where we're going to be during the next 6 month period.
Thank you. Judge. Any other comments?
Well, I'd like to say a couple of things. I've been doing a little bit of an analysis, and I didn't take into consideration the productivity pay, which is, that's an incentive program to try to reduce expenses, which in effect helps our fund balance as well. But I look at this as a business case to support reinstating that longevity pay just for this one time until we can take a look at the wage and salary study that we'll be looking at in the spring. But if you go with the premise that our staff, the staff of any organization, is the most important asset of the organization, and it's our county employees that really carry out the work of government, and it's important work. And it's important, I think, to the taxpayers that the people doing their work are engaged and motivated, that they're satisfied, because those kinds of staff are going to work a lot more effectively and efficiently, which saves us money in the long run. Mr. Reitenberry mentioned the costs of turnover, and those costs are real. And I don't know exactly what the turnover rate is, but I know that we have some, and particularly in certain areas. And I know that it's not, having satisfied and engaged employees isn't always just about the money. There are a lot of other factors too, and it's important to apply best employment practices. But the Wage and Salary Administration program is extremely important, and we're subject to the laws of the free marketplace when it comes to paying wages. We're just like any other business, and so we have to compete in the market for employees, and we really want to be able to get the best, attract the best, and retain the best. And if you think about what our staff do, I mean, we have a lot of professionals that are doing wonderful work for our community, and they're supported by really superb support staff. And I'm thinking about, I read in the paper somebody referred to our county employees as a bunch of bureaucrats. Well, that's not the case. I mean, I don't call our sheriff's deputies bureaucrats. They're out there keeping peace and making our community safe. And even people that work in the register of deeds, I mean, that's an important function. And we need people that are competent in order to maintain public records and make them accessible. I think about Susan Osborne's staff in the Department of Social Services and all the social workers out there working in adult and child protective services. These are professionals. People in the health department trying to make sure that we don't have spread of communicable diseases and making sure that the food in our restaurants are safe. People that manage our solid waste that we all generate. People that work in the emergency medical services, saving lives, EMTs, and all the staff there. People making sure that our buildings are safe, the fire marshal, the inspections department, our maintenance department, maintaining our library. So this is all important work, and I hate to start naming areas because every area is important. I'm going to leave some out, so that's not my intent to get everybody, but I know that when the longevity pay was taken away, I heard, this is way before I was even considering running for county commissioner, I heard from a lot of people how upset they were, and it really adversely affected morale, and I understand that morale is still being adversely affected from that decision. This was money that they counted on. It was really part of their compensation. They counted on it at the end of the year to pay expenses, maybe help out with Christmas. So, you know, we went through this hard time. We all went through. We went through it at Alamance Regional Medical Center during the Great Recession, and we all had to make sacrifices. And our county employees sacrificed. They didn't get any pay increases for several years or a few years. They actually got decreased pay because of the furloughs that they endured. Then there was a little bit of a takeaway in the 401k plan from the county. And I appreciate the fact, Commissioner Smith, that they got the 5% increase into their base pay during the time that the longevity pay was taken away in 2013. But they really didn't get a 5% increase because when you consider the decrease that they got from the longevity pay, it balanced out. It really affected different people differently depending how long the longevity was. So the people that had long longevity really ended up getting like a 1.5% increase. when you netted out that reduction in the longevity pay. So I guess, you know, I'm concerned about fund balance. I think that's really important, maintaining a good fund balance. That's the way we're evaluated from the outside, by the financial markets, by the credit world. So it's important that we do that. And I'm concerned about tax rates as well. You know, I appreciate that the value of all these added up, and I'll take your word for it, Commissioner Smith, that it adds up to 2 cents. I'm not sure about the valuation of the $500 productivity pay. But all in all, I think that the we want to spend our dollars wisely, and I think restoring it just for this one time would be a wise expenditure of our funds, and it would certainly send a good message to our staff that we appreciate what they do and that they're important to this community.
Any further comments?
Yeah, I want to go down memory lane here with some of the employees here, because in 2009 there were no salary increases. 2010, no salary increases. In fact, we made them take 5 furlough days because it was a hard time. We were really in a hard time in 2008-09, moving into one of the worst depressions we've been in since the Great Depression. And our county employees carried it on their back, and a lot of them stuck with us through the hard times. 2011, no salary increase. 2012, no salary increase. In fact, we made a different change on the 401k plan that employees had to contribute to get the match from the county on that. And yes, they did get a 5% salary increase last year. However, this longevity was done after it was already in the budget last year, and then it was taken away. And I think, and I'm like Bob, I've talked to a lot of people, and the ones that really hurt are the ones that have been very loyal to the county for the longest amount of time. It's not the ones that have been here 5 and 10 years, it's the ones been here the longest time. And I agree with Bob. I think this should be a one-time thing this year. We will look at the wage studies, but I know I've talked to Susan, and she's lost people over at social services, and they're hard to be replaced because those people have to be trained and they have to be qualified to do what they do. And yes, they do serve our people in our county. Bob covered it very well. And we want the best. If I'm out here in a wreck, I want the best EMT that I can get. And I don't want to worry about him being over in some other county and leaving this county because wages aren't competitive. So that's all I got to say with it.
Anybody else?
How many people in the private sector have gotten a 5% raise in the last 18 months or 2 years? Folks, the private sector is hurting. And there's no reason in the world to do this. It's a done deal. You might as well know that out there. This is a done deal. It's been a done deal since the election. So let's just be upfront about it. But if you're concerned about finances of the county and running a conservative county, then you've got to start looking at the whole ball of wax. And there's nobody in this county has gotten as much raise in the last, 5 years probably, because, yeah, we went through a tough time. But there are a lot of people who don't even have a job, or they've had to take part-time jobs now because of the Affordable Care Act, and employers can't afford it. But here we are going to give, a couple of more percentage points when we could do it at the end of the year in the new budget. I can't buy it. And I'm not opposed to the employees at all. When I was county manager, the employees were my concern. But when I was elected a commissioner, the citizens of Alamance County became my concern. And that's what I am concerned about now and will continue to be for the next 2 years. And if I have to be the loyal opposition on this board for 2 years, then I'll do it. but I love them. I mean, they're friends of mine. We just have different ideas, and that may become more evident as we proceed. That's it, Mr. Chairman.
Well, in this particular case, it doesn't have anything to do with whether you're conservative or otherwise. It has to do with fairness. And Commissioner Boswell brought it up, and the way it was done, it wasn't in a fair way. It was after a budget had been approved. There was no shortage of funding. The funding was fine. And then at the end of a meeting, the motion was made, and it was seconded, and it was voted on. It was 3-2, and there went to 55%. It was just as simple as that. It is righting a wrong. When something is done is wrong, if you can right it, you can. And that's what we're fixing to do here in a second, I hope. So with that being said, I'll make a motion that for one time that we approve the 55% that was cut in the 55% longevity that was cut in the 2012-2013 budget, that we make that motion at this time. Is that good enough, Mr. Honeycutt, what you need?
It's 13-14. And this is a one-time, it's not added to base salary, that this is a separate check that will be given to employees.
That is correct. All right, you've heard the motion. Do I have a second?
I'll second the motion.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no?
No.
The motion's approved. Thank you. All right, moving on, we have the addendum to the Sheets Distribution Services. Mr. Honeycutt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A very short addendum. If the board will remember, we have an incentive agreement with Sheets, and that was supposed to begin payout in 2016. The request from Sheets is that they have already got all their investment in. They've already at their job max qualifications now, that they would like to receive funding in 2015. So they'll just push it up a year. And the payment does not get until we receive our taxes.
Right.
So again, this we're also waiting for the final tax valuation, which we'll find out in January as well.
Right. Thank you, sir. Any questions for Mr. Honeycutt?
So we're still going to be net positive on
net
the tax
positive
versus
yes,
the
sir.
Incentive.
Yeah, very, very much so. And again, we're thinking we should be over what we originally agreed to as far as the
capital expenditures.
Yes, sir. Of your capital good. Investment. Yes, sir.
So I entertain a motion at this time that we do move up this proceeding.
Make a motion to move it up.
Motion. Have a second. Second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Ayes have it. Thank you. The adoption of the regular meetings. Members, you have a copy of the meeting schedule there in your packets or on your screen. There's only one change in terms of the number of dates. Normally we take the first meeting in January off.
Yes, sir.
However, because of business, we're going to be here and meet.
Yes, sir.
Is the plan if this is approved tonight. So just because of the business, we've got a lot going on right now. So
and also the thought process in talking with the chairman was after our first business meeting, to have a month between our next business meeting, there's a lot of meetings that I think we have coming up that we need to make sure are on our calendar and move forward.
Thank you, sir.
Also, make note, the second meeting is not on a Monday, it's on a
Tuesday,
besides the Martin Luther King
yes, sir.
Holiday.
That is correct. So with that in mind, do I have a motion that we approve the meeting assignments as written?
I make that motion.
All right.
Second.
Motion and second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Ayes have it. Thank you. And then the committee assignments. Any questions on the committee assignments for this coming year? I think you have those. I don't think we need to vote on those, do we? Just you have them, and everybody, unless there's a...
are we going to address the mental health one that was still unassigned? Is that...
Yeah, we can do that.
I mean, we don't need to do it at this meeting.
I'm still waiting to get information back. I had a conversation with David Carter, and he was supposed to get with Cardinal Innovation and get me that information back. So,
Cardinal, and so we're waiting to hear back from them, and for those,
right.
You know, that could possibly be another committee assignment.
Right. Yes, sir.
And you'll report back to us.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. And then we have a approval, thank you, approval of a voting delegate for 2015 North Carolina Association of County Commissioners and NACO Conference. And Ms. Massey, if you're willing to take it. You got it. All right. Thank you, ma'am. And I guess we need to vote on that.
Yes, sir.
So do I have a motion that Ms. Massey handle this assignment?
I make a motion she handle it.
I second. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you, ma'am. We appreciate you doing that. All right, DSS budget. We have a budget amendment. Ms. Auburn's coming from the back room.
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening. So every year, Social Services in February gets their budget estimates, and that's what we base our budget on when we're doing our budgeting for you in the spring and when you pass the budget in June. And then as the legislature finalizes the budget and as the money's all allocated, we start getting in our allocation letters. And so a couple of times a year, we have to bring those and kind of shore up everything from what was estimated and what we actually got received. So you'll see some additional SSBG, some less money in crisis intervention. Crisis intervention comes to us in pots of money depending on how cold or how hot it is, so we may well get some more of that, but this just shores everything up. So you have this list. This is a net positive of $241,000. The legislature passed two new pots of money, and they're listed on the last two on your revenues. Child welfare state in-home of $65,000 and CPS state of $190,000 for staffing of children's services for the counties. And so that's the additional funds, basically, that totals the net increase of $241,000 for the DSS budget. We may be chatting about some more staff as we really take stock of these funds and look at 6 months and how we're pulling down our revenues.
Any questions, Commissioner? All right. That do I hear a motion?
I'll move. We accept that.
All right. I'll second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
Thank you,
Ms. Auburn. Appreciate it. All right. County Attorney's Report.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. Mr. Albright.
You may remember the big drug bust that we had in this county. Compliments of my favorite client here. I got a phone call that morning. Yeah. The Federal Bureau of Investigation had to move an informant, had to move him quick. He didn't have any transportation. We had a car valued at about $1,000. So I prepared an in-kind contribution for him, and I'm asking the board's approval of that transfer of that vehicle. It was a small vehicle. I don't want to give the identity, the color, the year, because they may be looking for the guy in that car. But it's about $1,000 of value. It was a drug forfeiture car, but it was titled in the name of the county. I had Susan Roberts come to my office and sign the title over to this individual, and we have a written agreement with the FBI, and no underhanded dealings took place. The FBI warranted that they have all rights necessary to perform the agreement without restriction. And I just want to make that report to you and ask for your approval.
All right, sir. Thank you, Ms. Albright. Questions from commissioners? Probably best if we don't ask any.
No, probably better not.
Do I hear a motion?
Motion. Make a motion.
I'll second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you, Mr. Albright.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. All right, Mr. Honeycutt, County Manager's Report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of dates to remember. Thursday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. is the County Christmas Luncheon, which will be at Graham Rec. So it is Ugly Sweater Day, Ugly Christmas Sweater. So you can borrow something from the sheriff of what he's wearing now. This is pick on the sheriff day. But no, we would love to have you. And again, from 11 to 2 over at Graham Rec. So make sure you're invited to that. One thing I do want to mention to you, If you remember, we sold our beds, our nursing home beds, to Peak Resources. There is a public hearing, but since they're relocating to the old Grand Manor site, that public hearing will be held this Wednesday at 342 South Spring Street in Burlington from 11 to 12 p.m. It's not important that we go. I don't think there should be any opposition to the relocation, but I just wanted to give you that as just an update. And also, making sure everybody has on their calendar our quarterly SOAR award, our employee recognition breakfast, will be January 7th at 8:30 a.m. at the Family Justice Center in the basement. And that's all I have, other than a Merry Christmas.
Thank you, Ms. Honeycutt. Commissioners' comments. Who'd like to start?
Well, I'd like to make a comment.
All right, sir.
You know, I have this background in strategic planning, many years doing that at Alamance Regional, and I'd like to see our county government do a strategic plan. Strategic planning is so important because it really helps us to prioritize how we should spend our money. It typically involves making sure that we all agree to a vision as to where we want our county to go in the future. We usually, in a planning process like this, we review our mission. I don't know if everybody realizes what the mission of a county government should be. So I think it would be a good exercise, and then develop a plan on how best to carry out that mission and achieve that vision in the future. So it's a great way to prioritize how we spend our money. It helps to ensure future success. And typically, you know, a strategic plan is going to include a long-range financial plan. You know, you set targets. We know 5 years from now our fund balance needs to be so and so, and that's our target. So then the strategic plan is geared, you know, to try to reach that target. Also, we need to be looking at a facilities plan as part of a strategic plan, because we know that I think that I've been hearing, I don't know what the status of all of our facilities are, but I think we have some facilities needs, and we can't just take care of all those at one time. We wouldn't be able to afford that. But if we know what those needs are, and we can plan out over time how we're going to spend money on facilities, that would be a great idea. I don't know if Craig, you and your planning staff could maybe think about that and come back with some ideas about how to proceed.
So, director is here tonight.
One thing I'll say is that we all were at the Chamber of Commerce retreat, and we heard a lot of strategic plans.
Yeah.
It was the name of the retreat was From Vision to Reality. And we heard some really great speakers. We heard from the mayor of Winston-Salem about all the planning that they did and to reinvent Winston-Salem after they lost all of their major employers. And we heard from the city of Mebane, the town of Elon, the city of Burlington, city of Graham, and their strategic plans. We heard the school system strategic plan. We heard the Chamber of Commerce strategic plan. And here we are,
ACC.
County government without a strategic, and ACC's, yeah, and theirs. So I think that we need to go through a process and try to make sure that we're in sync with all the other public community strategic plans out there as well.
Well, the county had a plan, 2020 plan. Dan, you know all about the 2020 plan. I don't know what happened.
I've looked at that. It's a decent plan. I mean, it's old. It needs to be updated at the very least.
It should be updated. Right.
And,
it's a good format.
But we need to make sure that when we do a plan, that it's in front of us all the time, and that we make our decisions based on the strategies that we came up with in that plan, and so that it doesn't just sit on a shelf.
Yeah,
that's how organizations move forward and progress.
I know in the ABSS, and Ms. Thompson, welcome. We had the chair of the ABSS here tonight, and Pam Thompson. But in their facilities plan, it's about 9 pages in their strategic plan on facilities.
And I meant to mention that because a big part of our budget is supporting ABSS, and so their plan and our plan, particularly when it comes to facilities, since we're responsible for your facilities and our facilities, they need to be in sync.
Yeah.
So, but we have other facilities in addition to the school system's facilities to worry about as well.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Burton.
Hello. I think that's great, and I do think we need to start looking at some building plans, because having moved the inspection and planning and everybody moving over to Graham Hopedale, there's, I guess Brian's been working on some of those, but we need to address those and look at them, because we're going to have to make some changes. Also, our inspection, head of inspection is leaving too, Bob Stowbridge, and I guess the county is on track to replace him. And I sent Craig a recommendation today.
Appreciate that as well. Thank you.
Talk to those people, but yeah.
You're right on track tonight, Bob.
If the board is agreeable, maybe not at the January 5th meeting, but maybe the 15th meeting, we can kind of give you an update of maybe a possible direction to go, and working with staff, we can make a presentation to you, if that's fine with you, on how we would like, maybe recommend to see him moving forward with his strategic type plan or updating the 2020 plan.
Sounds good. Sounds good.
Okay. That's
more
to do with.
Any others?
Yeah, let me say that 30 years ago, I may have denied the county attorney's motion before me, but I did hire him sometimes later as the assistant county attorney, and then I recommended him to be county attorney, and he has not let me down. He learned a lot of law in between the times.
Judge, you made a good choice.
Yes, yes, you did.
Thank you, Judge. All right, Linda, you have anything?
Well, I just want to tell everybody, if I can get it out, Megan killed herself last week, and I went to her funeral. She's the little girl that just talked to us less than a month ago, yeah. And she took an overdose. So just be in prayer for her family.
Yeah.
She actually spoke to the this board, what, a couple of occasions?
Well, just recently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Such a tragedy.
Yeah, it
so
was.
Young, about 17 years old.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Linda. A couple things. We have an invitation from Ms. Thompson, the chairman of ABSS. Tomorrow they are going to be serving, some members of the board are going to be serving faculty and staff at Graham Middle School. And if we'd like to drop by, I think we should wear old clothes, I understand, because it's probably going to put us to work.
Sound like it's going to put us to work.
Yeah, if we do decide to drop by. So it's going to be Graham Police and also some ABSS staff. So if you have a chance, want to drop by there about 10:30, feel free to do so. And also, we have a DARE graduation at Be Everett Jordan Thursday. I think that's at 9. Does that sound right, Sheriff? If it's wrong, I'll tell you. But I'll be speaking that morning. If you'd like to come by, I'll recognize you, and feel free to do so. And that's all I have. All I have this time. So being no further business, meeting's adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.